history's verdict. Hitler. He was utterly convinced of his own greatness. He believed in total war and the myth that the German army had been stabbed in the back in 1918. He was obsessed with the idea that Jews and communists were conspiring to destroy Germany. General Erich Ludendorff certainly had much in common with Adolf Hitler. However, their differences were more revealing. Pulitzer Prize winner Barbara Tuchman noted that Ludendorff was a granite character, deliberately friendless. Hitler, by contrast, had many friends, and he was almost invariably loyal to them, even when they proved to be disastrously incompetent. Benito Mussolini was one of them, and via his lover's secret diary, published in 2009, he revealed that Hitler is an old sentimentalist at heart. Hitler was, after all, a man who would cover his eyes when watching sad scenes in melodramatic movies, or openly weep when his pet dogs fell ill. There were more contrasts. Ludendorff was a glutton for work. Hitler was lazy and indolent, sleeping very late and incapable of sustained intellectual or physical effort. Ludendorff had been a brilliant student at officer school. Hitler struggled at every stage of education. His dream of becoming an acclaimed artist was shattered when the Academy of Fine Arts in Vienna rejected his application twice. This was not because Hitler lacked talent. He was praised for his landscapes and buildings. Ominously, though, the professors noted his inability to depict human beings. Finally, Ludendorff had been born into a happy, partly noble family. Hitler's humble home life had been dominated by his hated, hard-drinking father's bullying of his beloved, gentle mother. For the rest of his life, he had a picture of his mother in his bedroom or study. Unfortunately for the world, his personality would resemble much more that of his brow-beating father, who administered near-fatal beatings to the young Adolf. Hitler's assumption of power in 1933 brought forth one staggeringly accurate prediction from Ludendorff. "I solemnly prophesy that this accursed man will cast our Reich into the abyss and bring inconceivable misery upon our nation." The young Hitler was an unlikely candidate to cause such cataclysmic suffering for Germany and the world. German historian Anton Joachim Staller even discovered evidence that the teenage Hitler was not yet an anti-Semite. For years in Linz, Hitler's obsession was his unrequited love for a pretty girl he was convinced was Jewish, Stephanie Isaac. Hitler never spoke to her, but he did write her anonymous love letters, promising he would return from the academy to marry her. Disturbingly, though, and foreshadowing the fate of his future female companions, he vowed that if Stephanie did not accept, he would jump in the river. But Stephanie would have to die with him. He insisted on that. Kubizek, Hitler's friend, told how the future Führer despised the aristocratic young army officers who courted Stephanie. Hitler's resentment of the officer class would also stay with him for life and dictate much of the course of the Second World War. Hitler admitted he only became anti-Semitic when he moved to Vienna. In the great city, he cut a pathetic figure. Failure in love and art, combined with his own physical weakness, condemned him to the life of a poor tramp. His drifting existence only coming to an end when the outbreak of war found him living in Germany. The great war that caused tragedy for millions would, paradoxically, provide Hitler with companionship, happiness, and a sense of purpose. Most of his comrades died, and Hitler came close to death on several occasions, reinforcing his sense of destiny, as he later remarked, I thanked heaven for granting me the good fortune of being permitted to live at this time. He won the Iron Cross twice, including the rare first-class version. Hugo Guttmann, a Jewish officer, nominated Hitler for it. His thanks, being arrested by the Gestapo in 1937. Hitler was blinded by mustard gas, contributing to his own refusal to authorize the deployment of Germany's chemical weapons in the Second World War. He would, of course, unhesitatingly permit the use of gas to murder Jewish and other civilians. Whilst recovering in hospital, he received the news that would traumatize him and millions of other patriots. Germany, which had so recently conquered vast new Lebensraum in the east and whose invincible army occupied much of France, had surrendered. The war was lost. The Treaty of Versailles would soon complete the humiliation. Hitler had found his life's mission. Confined to bed, the idea came to me that I would liberate Germany, that I would make it great.
The end of the Great War witnessed the genesis of the Hitler of the Second World War. It was now that his ideas coalesced into a vision that would drive him for the rest of his life. The defeated and demoralized people of Germany would be united into a new national community, the Volksgemeinschaft. A new and more awesome war machine would be built. And with this war machine, he would avenge the humiliation by defeating the bullies of Versailles, Britain and France. In turn, Germany would become the most powerful country on earth, also thanks to a vast racist empire in the Lebensraum that would be conquered in the east. And the Jewish Bolsheviks, the people he blamed for the stab in the back in 1918, well, they would be exterminated.
Hitler achieved many of these objectives. The only doubt is whether he did so in an opportunistic, haphazard fashion, or, as the great but controversial German historian Andreas Hilgruber believed, by following a stage-by-stage Stufenplan for world domination that he developed in the 1920s. To transform his apocalyptic vision into reality, Hitler needed power. His attempt to seize it by force ended rather absurdly following the Beer Hall Putsch. His subsequent spell in prison gave him time to dictate Mein Kampf, a boring and largely incoherent work which is, nonetheless, horribly frank at times. It spells out Hitler's worldview and makes clear that his hatred of the Jews had now become pathological. If, during the war, 12 or 15,000 of these Hebrew nation corruptors had been held under poison gas, then the sacrifice of millions on the front would not have been in vain. The failure of his coup made Hitler turn to more conventional political methods to take control of the nation. There was still a place for the street-fighting brown-shirt thugs, but Hitler was also rapidly proving he had a talent for winning over crowds. This skill would be reinforced by the advice of Dr. Joseph Goebbels, described by Niall Ferguson as the evil genius of 20th century marketing. Albert Speer, Hitler's pet architect, showed he too had a flair for propaganda when he devised the visual look of Hitler's most famous public appearances, the vast Nazi rallies. Yet Hitler remained the central figure in this public relations strategy. As Professor Sir Richard Overy observed, the secret of Hitler's success, the way that he was able to captivate people, to hold a whole crowd under his spell, is that he was a terrific actor. Everything he did was theatrical. Hitler was not stupid and knew how to make himself attractive to vast numbers of people. Recent historical research shows that the Nazi Party truly gained across-the-board support from German society. The working and middle classes, the rural population and those in cities, Catholics and Protestants, the business and military elites, all provided supporters for the Nazis. Today, he is often regarded as simply a curtain-chewing madman, largely due to the perceived image of the Hitler of the last days in the bunker. But he was, in truth, a remarkably skilled political operator. André-François Poncet, the French ambassador, correctly affirmed, he was an ice-cold realist, a profoundly calculating person. Hitler, the anonymous, frustrated worshipper of Stephanie Isaac, was even becoming attractive to German women. He started to receive many letters from admirers, even love letters. For some unfortunate women, this fatal attraction was literal. His niece, Geli, with whom he lived and may have loved, shot herself. Renate Müller, another possible lover, also killed herself. Unity Mitford and Maria Reiter would also attempt suicide. Most famously, Eva Braun, whom Hitler first met in the 1920s and who would be his close, if secret, companion for the last 12 years of their lives, also died by her own hand. The disastrous economic conditions in Germany were also making many people receptive to Hitler's message of national regeneration and redemption. His promises of jobs, enhanced family life, restored pride, strengthened communities, and great future for young Germans were all sincere. Who can blame millions of people for voting for these and ignoring the suffering of those people excluded from the Nazi utopia? However, the price Hitler would eventually demand of these supporters was to be truly nightmarish for Germany and the world. In August 1939, even as he was imminently poised to destroy Poland, he was confessing to visiting diplomats, "All the steps I am taking are aimed against Russia. If the West is too stupid and too blind to understand this, I will have to sign a pact with the Russians, destroy the West, and after it falls, gather all the forces and turn them against the Soviet Union." But Poland would come first. Poland infuriated him simply by existing. It was not a real country. Its people, an inferior race illegally occupying territory needed for his Lebensraum. Its government had also spurned Hitler's invitation to form an alliance against Stalin. So, it would be the first country on which he would unleash the war machine that rearmament had built. On the 31st of August 1939, Generaloberst Brauchitsch was reporting that the Führer was very calm and had slept very well. Hitler's tranquility came from his conviction that the leaders of Britain and France, Chamberlain and Daladier, would not declare war on Germany in support of Poland. After all, Anglo-French appeasement, which culminated in Munich in 1938, had allowed him to dismember democratic Czechoslovakia, seizing its impressive industries, defenses and weapons without a single shot being fired. Hitler had yearned to see his superbly trained and equipped Wehrmacht go into battle in 1938, and he had been disappointed at how easily a bloodless victory had been achieved. This caused him to remark of the leaders of Britain and France that "our enemies are little worms. The men I got to know at Munich are not the kind that start a new world war." Hitler was partly wrong. Even the worms of Munich would honor their alliance with Poland, and partly right. The British and French premiers would not start this new and even more horrendous world war. Hitler himself would, and he would do so through a cruel act of blatant deceit. The first person who would die in history's worst ever war at the command of the Führer, the self-proclaimed savior of his nation, blood and soil, was a German farmer, Franz Honiok. His crime? To be sympathetic to his Polish neighbors. His fate? To be arrested by the Gestapo, drugged, dressed in a stolen Polish uniform, then murdered by the SS. His corpse was dumped beside a German radio station on the evening of the 31st of August, 1939. This provided Hitler with the proof of Polish aggression that gave him the excuse to unleash his blitzkrieg on Poland. Hitler's assault on Poland, codenamed Fall Weiss, or Case White, would indeed be lightning quick, but it would be far from clean. Or against women and children, I have ordered my air force to restrict itself to attacks on military objectives. In accordance with his true wishes, the Luftwaffe, the world's most feared air force, thanks to the experience it had gained slaughtering civilians in Spain, launched the invasion by killing 1,200 civilians in the terror bombing of a quiet town. Equally cynically, a German battleship, which had been welcomed into Polish waters on a goodwill visit, began bombarding a Polish fortress. At dawn, 1.8 million German troops, as well as 50,000 Slovakian soldiers, attacked Poland. The outnumbered Polish forces were not even fully mobilized, nor were they armed with the vehicles, weapons, and tactics necessary to hold back the Nazi hordes long enough for their hoped-for relief by the French and British. Even the relatively flat landscape of Poland favored the rapidly moving invaders. Despite these massive disadvantages, the Poles fought heroically. Hitler was not impressed. For him, the death of any German soldier in battle was to be treated as murder. The majority of his commanders were indeed quite happy to treat the Poles inhumanely and illegally. Medical posts were attacked. Men who had surrendered were murdered. Prisoners were used as human shields. Similar atrocities were also being inflicted on Polish civilians. Hitler himself had made it clear to his senior officers in an August conference how to deal with Poland. Close your heart to pity. Act brutally. 80 million Germans must obtain their right. The wholesale destruction of Poland is your primary objective. Complete annihilation. Hitler predicted that Poland's allies would not intervene. But on the third day of the invasion, Britain and France did declare war. On receiving the news, the ever-talkative Hitler and Goebbels were stunned into silence. Goering, by contrast, moaned. "If we lose this war, then God have mercy on us." The Polish army was inflicting tens of thousands of casualties on the invaders. The Poles expected to put up indefinite resistance to the invaders in the hope that their allies would mount a relief offensive. Hitler had other plans, and following a secret protocol of his euphemistically named non-aggression treaty with the Soviet Union, he had an ally of his own lurking in the east. Hitler had spent 20 years railing against an imaginary stab in the back by communist conspirators as the cause of the downfall of the Kaiser's invincible army in 1918. Now he turned to the Bolshevik Stalin to plunge a dagger between the shoulder blades of proud Poland. The Red Army invasion of eastern Poland sounded the death knell for Polish hopes. Millions of Poles were condemned to utter misery under the two totalitarian dictators. Hitler, arguably for the first time, showed he could be even more monstrous than Stalin. Poland's intellectuals, professionals, political and military leaders, academics and aristocrats were to be eliminated, as would its Jewish citizens. The rest of the population was to be enslaved. The blonde beast, Reinhard Heydrich, Himmler's equally murderous deputy, made it clear. The little people we want to spare, but the nobles, priests, and Jews must be killed. To guarantee this, Hitler sent in the specialist murderers of the SS Einsatzgruppen. Shockingly, 60% of these death squad commanders held doctorates. Among the first victims of Hitler's doctors were patients from Polish psychiatric hospitals. Many were murdered in gas chambers, the first people Nazism would liquidate using this method, though sadly, very far from the last. Gassing those unfit for life would almost instantly be applied to Hitler's German subjects too, starting with handicapped children. Hitler's euthanasia program, Action T4, would kill at least 200,000 of his own citizens. On the 9th of April, 1940, Hitler's forces were back in Blitzkrieg mode, invading Denmark and Norway simultaneously. Hitler had now secured the vital iron ore supply route from neutral Sweden. He had gained valuable new bases for U-boat operations, and most importantly, Hitler had taken sides in the great debate dividing his generals. Von Manstein and Guderian proposed daring concentrations of armored forces and a surprise attack through the Ardennes region in Operation Fallgelb, Case Yellow. This had been rejected by the rest of the High Command. When it was leaked to Hitler, however, his gambler's instinct approved it. Shortly before the attack, he promised his generals, "Gentlemen, you are about to witness the most famous victory in history." The opposing forces appeared evenly matched. So how did Hitler win the Battle of France? In the corridors of power, coordination between his opponents was very poor. The neutral Dutch and Belgians did little to allow the French to contribute to their defense. The British Expeditionary Force chafed at being placed under French command. In the skies, Göring's Luftwaffe boasted huge superiority, 2,500 aircraft against a few hundred, largely obsolete, British and French aeroplanes. From the skies, Nazi gliders and paratroopers dropped at dawn on the 10th of May. This caused consternation among Belgian and Dutch troops, whose commanders had hoped their nation's neutrality would keep them out of harm's way. On the ground, British and French troops abandoned their defenses in northern France and rushed into Belgium in a vain attempt to halt Hitler's armored divisions. This was exactly what the Germans wanted. The gentle, unfortified countryside was perfect for Hitler's onrushing panzers. German tank divisions attacked autonomously, with Wehrmacht infantry following through the holes in enemy lines to mop up Allied soldiers. Amidst the incredible success of that first day, one fact might easily have escaped Hitler's notice. Britain had a new leader. Neville Chamberlain had been replaced by Winston Churchill. The worm of Munich had made way for the bulldog of Blenheim.
although both leaders had artistic inclinations, were very, very good public speakers, and had shown great courage under fire, Hitler and Churchill were very different personalities. Churchill was an aristocratic man of the world. He liked to drink and smoke a lot, and he was also a workaholic. Additionally, Churchill loved female company. However, strangely, he was a notoriously rude boss. By contrast, Hitler didn't drink or smoke. He was very shy in the company of women, and he avoided hard work as much as possible. However, the biggest difference came with the decisiveness of the two men. Hitler was very indecisive. He was also almost pathologically resistant to criticism or advice. Churchill was incredibly decisive. And while he could be just as stubborn as Hitler, he was very, very open to taking advice and suggestions and criticism from the people around him who knew better than he did.
But this was not to be Churchill's day. The French army, in a strategy of blind complacency, depended far too much on the Maginot Line. The Germans bypassed this vast chain of fortifications by launching another, even bigger attack through the hilly and forested landscape of the Ardennes, which had been deemed, by the Allies, as unsuitable for a Nazi invasion. The Hitler-approved von Manstein plan meant that the Maginot Line was not only irrelevant as a barrier, but was an obstacle to the French. The huge numbers of troops occupying its vast chain of fortresses might otherwise have been fighting the Nazis now overrunning their country. Entire French and British armies were soon trapped between the Wehrmacht and the English Channel. Their plight was so grave that King George called for a week of prayer. In Christian churches and Jewish synagogues throughout Britain, people prayed for divine intervention to save the army. But it would be a diabolical and yet all too human figure that would intervene. In a mystifying instruction, Hitler ordered Guderian to halt his panzers before Dunkirk. The ensuing pause allowed defences to be prepared that would make the miracle of Dunkirk possible. Goering begged Hitler for the chance to finish off the British army in Dunkirk, but the RAF matched the Luftwaffe long enough for the greatest evacuation in history to take place. This saved most of Britain's professional soldiers, along with 100,000 French troops. By June the 5th, however, Hitler was ecstatic. Dunkirk has fallen. With it has ended the greatest battle of world history. The British won't come back in this war. Mussolini ordered his own army to join in the attack on France on the 10th of June. On the 22nd of June, France capitulated. To humiliate the French, Hitler made sure the armistice ceremony took place in the same railway carriage used in 1918 for German generals to acknowledge their defeat. The world was stunned. Hitler was jubilant. He visited Paris to seek inspiration for the grandiose world capital he was planning. He told Speer that, "When we have finished in Berlin, Paris will only be a shadow." The defeat of France was the crucial moment that solidified both Hitler's megalomania and his hubris. It confirmed in his mind what he thought of as his ordinary soldier's military brilliance, in contrast to the conservatism of his aristocratic generals. Dr. Jeffrey Megagee of the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum admits Hitler did have a raw talent for strategy. He was, after all, one of the two men who first thought up the campaign plan that the Wehrmacht, the German army, used against France with such stunning success in 1940. And he had to push hard before the general staff would accept it. According to the late Professor Gordon Craig of Stanford University, this astonishingly lucky gamble prompted Hitler's sycophantic General Keitel to exclaim, "Mein Führer, you are the greatest warlord of all time." Unfortunately for Hitler, he began to believe it too. De Gaulle realized this meant a European conflict would now escalate. This war is a worldwide war. In Asia, the collapse of such a great European imperial power gave heart to the aggressive expansionists in Japan. These men had their own visions of building a vast racist empire. The Rape of Nanking, in which atrocities were committed against hundreds of thousands of Chinese victims, or the human experiments of Unit 731, would prove grim inspiration for Hitler's own horrors in Eastern Europe. In Moscow, Hitler's ally in all but name, Stalin, was staggered by the Nazis' rapid victory over France. He now faced the horrifying realization that his Soviet Union would inevitably become the prime target for the Nazi war machine. Khrushchev recalled, "Stalin let fly with some choice Russian curses and said that now Hitler was sure to beat our brains in." The destruction of the Soviet Union was the goal of Hitler's dystopian plans for his own colossal racist empire. This would ensure that Germany dominated Europe and enable it to fight the USA for mastery of the world. Plans were being drawn up that would allow an attack on the Western Hemisphere in conjunction with the soon-to-be subdued British. Goering, in another of his own wildly inaccurate prophecies, promised Hitler that Britain could be defeated by air power alone. "My Luftwaffe is invincible. And now we turn to England. How long will this one last? 2, 3 weeks? Towards the end of summer 1940, the RAF did come perilously close to defeat. But their comrades in Bomber Command counterattacked Germany. So incensed was Hitler by these raids that he ordered the Luftwaffe to switch to terror bombing British cities. This relieved the pressure on RAF Fighter Command and also helped unite the population of Britain in turn. By September the 15th, the Battle of Britain was over. It was Hitler's first defeat of the war. Nazi attacks on the British changed element, from the sky to the sea. Admiral Dönitz's U-boat Wolfpacks were lethally effective in winter 1940-41. The Royal Navy seemed impotent to stop them. To the Kriegsmarine submariners, this period was known as the happy time. Even Churchill admitted that the only thing that ever really frightened me during the war was the U-boat peril. Meanwhile, Hitler formalized an alliance with other powers keen to establish a new order across the globe. In September 1940, he signed the Tripartite Pact with Italy and Japan. They would be joined over the next year by other authoritarian regimes determined to destroy the status quo: Hungary, Romania, Slovakia, and Bulgaria. This Axis alliance fueled the hubris of its leaders and their conviction they would conquer the world between them. But what is truly remarkable is how it revealed they were almost laughably unable to communicate with each other, let alone coordinate military strategy. Stalin, Roosevelt, and Churchill could work together, despite massive gulfs in their personalities and philosophies. But Germany, Japan and Italy constantly unpleasantly surprised each other with secret plans. Hitler's own racist worldview even placed a rather obvious limit on his respect for Japan, by far his most powerful, ambitious and ruthless ally. It goes without saying that we have no affinities with the Japanese. When the Axis partners did take action together, they frequently hindered one another's grandiose plans. In spring 1941, Hitler intervened to bolster Mussolini's inept operations in North Africa, the Balkans, and the Middle East. These were annoying diversions from his true goal. Hitler, along with almost his entire general staff and many observers worldwide, was convinced victory in the East would be easy. He promised his commanders that, in the USSR, you only have to kick in the door and the whole rotten structure will come crashing down. To kick in the door, Hitler unleashed the jackboots of over 3 million German troops, backed by another 500,000 soldiers from Italy, Romania, Hungary, Slovakia, Spain, and Finland.
The Generalplan Ost for the conquered Soviet Union and the rest of Eastern Europe almost defies belief for the scale and the sadistic cruelty of its intentions. Tens of millions of people were to die of starvation so that their food could be given to Germans. This was known with chilling clarity as the Hunger Plan. Around 45 million more people were to be deported to Siberia as racially undesirable individuals. The German leadership actually hoped that they would simply die of cold or starvation in Siberia. The rest of the people left in the conquered area, around 50 million, were to become slaves of the German master race.
This staggering scheme would never be fully implemented, but many millions of people would die or endure virtually unimaginable suffering in its pursuit. The Dantesque project that would create hell on earth for so many was considered by Hitler necessary to create a German Garden of Eden stretching to the Urals. When Barbarossa begins, the world will hold its breath and make no comment.
The German bombs rained out.
His equally talkative enemy, Churchill, did make comment. He predicted that the Nazi will to power meant that even the destruction of the entire Soviet Union would not sate Hitler's lust for death, and that Barbarossa will itself be only a stepping stone. The lives and happiness of 1,000,000,000 additional human beings are now menaced with brutal Nazi violence. Hitler's invasion of the Soviet Union reached its furthest point on the 2nd of December 1941, when some officers glimpsed the spires of the Kremlin through their binoculars. Shortly afterwards, a giant Soviet counterattack took the Wehrmacht by surprise. Hitler and his arrogant generals had badly underestimated the size of the Red Army and its capacity to regroup, fight back, and inflict casualties on the invaders. Hitler had also badly underestimated Stalin. The Soviet dictator lacked Hitler's rhetorical skill, gambler's instincts, and talent for strategy. Stalin was also, like Churchill, a heavy drinker, but he was also immensely intelligent, a tireless worker, and with an extraordinary eye for key details. Perhaps most crucially, Stalin was utterly unsentimental. This was, after all, a man who declared his own son a traitor merely for being taken as a prisoner of war by the Germans. He unhesitatingly did everything in his vast power to win this war of annihilation that Hitler had so greatly desired. Hitler, by contrast, wanted a quick victory so that the German public at home would not have to make even small sacrifices. This meant that Germany did not mobilize for total war until it was far too late. Hitler's own racist philosophy was proving counterproductive. In the words of Mark Solomon, weird ideas of biological supremacy couldn't stop bullets ripping through his soldiers' flesh. Nazi hatred of inferior races meant all such peoples were to be treated with the utmost harshness. Even Stalinism seemed mild in comparison. This spurred indomitable resistance to the Nazis. Hitler's soldiers would still kill many millions more in the conquered territories, however. But Churchill was to be proved right once more when he said on December the 11th, "In Hitler's launching of the Nazi campaign in Russia, we can already see, after 6 months of fighting, that he has made one of the outstanding blunders in history." On the very same day of Churchill's pronouncement, Hitler would make an equally historic blunder. Under no obligation to do so, following the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor, Hitler declared war on the USA. Yet again, Hitler's powers of prophecies proved effective. "I don't see much future for the Americans. It's a decayed country. My feelings against Americanism are feelings of hatred and deep repugnance. Everything about the behavior of American society reveals that it's half Judaized and the other half negrified. How can one expect a state like that to hold together?" Hitler's megalomania and lust for violence now had him at war with the world's largest empire, the world's most powerful economy, and the world's biggest army. The very next day, Hitler may have far surpassed even the infamy of Pearl Harbor. Many historians have long been convinced that Hitler authorized the Holocaust, but have been frustrated in their attempts to find proof of this. However, German researcher Christian Gerlach may well have discovered incriminating evidence of Hitler's culpability in the greatest crime of all time. Hitler spoke confidentially in his private rooms to his most trusted supreme Nazi henchman. Gerlach analyzed notes and comments by Goebbels, Himmler, and Hans Frank about Hitler's secret speech. His conclusion was clear. The 12th of December 1941 was the day that Hitler ordered the systematic murder of all Europe's Jews. "In respect of the Jewish question, the Führer has decided," said Goebbels, "to make a clean sweep. The world war is here. The annihilation of the Jews must be the necessary result." On the 18th of December, Himmler sought further clarification. In response to his question, "What to do with the Jews of Russia?" Hitler replied, "Exterminate them as partisans." Nancy Gibbs said of Hitler and the Holocaust, "Hitler's impact went beyond his willingness to kill without mercy. He did something civilization had not seen before. He set out to kill people not for what they did, but for who they were. Hitler killed a million Jewish babies just for existing." To save as many babies, Jews, and other victims from Hitler's Holocaust as possible, it would take the defeat of his still awesomely powerful armed forces. And in late 1942, Rommel's Africa Corps was defeated at the Battle of El Alamein, saving all of the Jews in Palestine from death squads and gas chambers. More Allied victories were to follow. In February 1943, the massive and massively savage Battle of Stalingrad ended with the destruction of the entire German Sixth Army. On hearing the devastating news from Stalingrad, Hitler's hubris dispersed long enough for him to remark, "The God of War has gone over to the other side." Hitler's disastrous management of strategy and his generals' inability to resist him doomed the Third Reich. Hitler's interference meant that an attack at Kursk, the last chance to defeat the Soviets, was delayed for months. Zhukov now had time to prepare his own attack and build a staggering series of defenses to absorb and then exhaust the German onslaught. He then inflicted on the Wehrmacht a decisive defeat in the biggest battle of all time. Hitler's poor leadership led Hans Mommsen to say that he was a weak dictator, unwilling to take decisions, frequently uncertain. Throughout 1943 and 1944, the Red Army pushed back Hitler's forces inexorably closer to Germany itself. German losses on the Eastern Front seemed endless, but more bad news came to Hitler's Wolf's Lair HQ. On the 6th of June 1944, D-Day, the American, British and Canadian forces landed in Normandy in the greatest amphibious operation in history. The Soviets were not to be outdone. Operation Bagration, launched on the 22nd of June, threw 2.5 million soldiers at Hitler's Army Group Center. This unstoppable advance would bring the Red Army to East Prussia. Disgruntled officers, unhappy that the war was going against them, now plotted to assassinate Hitler in a series of bungled attempts on his life. The results were disastrous. Hitler's vengeance on the plotters, their friends and families, was hideous. Hitler's popularity went up. Ordinary Germans, unaware, thanks to Goebbels' propaganda, that the military situation was hopeless, were stunned by what they saw as despicable treachery to the Führer. Hitler now surrounded himself with the extreme fanatics of the SS, convinced himself once again that destiny had saved him for some great purpose, and accelerated the Holocaust and his other vile plans. Not all of his citizens were happy to be, as Daniel Goldhagen controversially describes the German people who joined in the unconditional worship observed by neutral diplomats in Nazi Germany as Hitler's willing executioners. Nor did they all wish to be working towards the Führer, in Ian Kershaw's phrase, explaining how Hitler rarely needed to express his homicidal desires. Professor Mary Fulbrook of University College London insists that there were remarkable people who thought, "There is a struggle between good and evil. We have to make a stand." The most remarkable uncorrupted Germans of all were the young pacifists of the White Rose movement, who said, "For Hitler and his followers, there is no punishment on this earth commensurate with their crimes." Sadly, their almost unbelievably brave leaders would not live to see the end of Hitlerism. They were beheaded for treason following rigged trials in Nazi Volk courts. They, not the Führer of the thousand-year Reich, are now regularly voted by their modern compatriots as amongst the very greatest Germans of all time. By late 1944, the Allied armies were approaching Germany's borders. Hitler's last roll of the dice in the West was another surprise offensive in the Ardennes. When it failed, even Hitler and his devoted fanatics realized that Germany was going to lose the war unless some miracle occurred. Hitler placed fanatic hopes on the wonder weapons being developed in underground facilities manned by slave laborers. Ironically, many Jewish and other scientists who had fled his tyranny were helping the Allies to build their own wonder weapons, the atomic bombs of the Manhattan Project. However, the V-1 and V-2 missiles did not turn the tide of war. Hitler's last fleeting hope of salvaging his Reich came with the death of Roosevelt in April 1945. He and Goebbels were briefly convinced that the loss of the Jew-loving cripple would mean the collapse of the democracy's alliance with the USSR and a new pact with Hitler to destroy communism. When this deranged hope quickly evaporated, Hitler demanded the destruction of German industry and agriculture. This scorched earth order was designed to destroy German civilization and condemn millions of Germans to death in accordance with Hitler's belief that Germany must either be a world power or there will be no Germany. Nobel laureate and Auschwitz survivor Elie Wiesel said of Hitler's urge to destroy his own people, he wanted them to be sacked, destroyed, reduced to misery and shame for having failed him by denying him his glory. Hitler celebrated his 56th birthday on the 20th of April in the nightmarish atmosphere he had created in the bunker. Goebbels was still making great claims for the Führer. On this beautiful day, we celebrate the Führer's birthday and thank him, for he is the only reason why Germany is still alive today. Among the guests was Hitler's favorite doctor, Theodor Morell. He had the unenviable task of attending to the Führer's flatulence, as well as more serious illnesses, including high blood pressure, hepatitis, and visible Parkinson's disease. Many people were convinced that Morell was a quack, and Göring sarcastically called him the Reich's needle master. However, this is challenged by a remarkable 2010 study, Was Hitler Sick?, by historian Henrik Eberle and Hans-Joachim Neumann, a professor emeritus of medicine. Their study lists the many drugs Morell administered to Hitler. Testosterone, an extract derived from the semen of bulls. Pervitin, a form of the drug known today as speed. Methamphetamine, barbiturates, and opiates. Most of these would have been considered normal medications at the time. Their principal conclusions are that Morell was a competent physician simply cowed into obeying his employer, and that the drugs do not exonerate the Führer. At no time did Hitler suffer from pathological delusions. He was fully responsible for his actions. Some uninvited and unwelcome guests spoiled the birthday party. On hearing of the arrival of the Red Army in Berlin, Hitler raged dementedly at the treachery of his generals. He admitted, for the very first time, that the war was lost, and he vowed to shoot himself. His closest Nazi henchmen began turning on him. Göring sent Hitler an ultimatum claiming leadership of the Reich. Hitler ordered his arrest by the SS. But worse was to follow for Hitler, and it would come from the very top of his beloved SS. Himmler, a man whose loyalty to his Führer and his genocidal racist worldview was described by Norman Rich as single-minded to the verge of idiocy, and which led Hitler to affectionately dub him Faithful Heinrich, was attempting to negotiate with the Allies. Hitler's tantrum was the most demented ever seen by his staff. He also had Himmler's representative in the bunker, SS General Fegelein, shot. It mattered not to Hitler that this man was married to Eva Braun's sister. Had he lived, He would soon have become, albeit for a very short time, Hitler's brother-in-law. Appropriately enough, around midnight, the hour when the powers of evil are said to be exalted, on the 29th of April, Hitler married Eva Braun in the sulfurous stench and hellish gloom of the Führerbunker. The next day, he dictated his last will and testament. As the rats deserted his rapidly sinking ship, he passed on command to the head of his submarine force, Dönitz. Later that day, he received word that his friend Mussolini had been assassinated, and his body, and that of his lover, publicly humiliated. Hitler wanted no such honeymoon for himself and his bride. Hitler shot himself with the same pistol that his niece, Geli, had used in her suicide in 1931. Hitler's immediate legacy had condemned even his beloved fatherland to Armageddon. Millions of soldiers and civilians were dead, and millions of German women were cowering in fear of rape by the vengeful invaders. At least Germans were spared the fate of Hitler's Japanese allies. If his forces had fought on a little longer, they might even have doomed Germany to another kind of Holocaust, atomic bombing. The Soviets took great care to ensure Hitler's remains would never become relics. They were burned, the ashes ground up, then buried in secret by the NKVD. These ashes were disinterred by the KGB in 1970 to be burned again and scattered. A few fragments of bone have been kept in the Kremlin and even analyzed by an American forensic pathologist who confirmed they are Hitler's last remains. Hitler's demonic plans for the world continue to exert fascination, but thankfully, they only succeed in works of contrafactual history or science fiction. These frequently show a brutal Nazi-ruled world with no Jews, no blacks, women subjugated, and neo-pagan Führer worship as the single religion. The world that Hitler never made. For all its faults, the modern world is far from this hellish vision. The American theologian Martin Marty is convinced that the human race is evolving beyond such monstrous cruelty and that Hitler's megalomania is irrelevant. In five centuries, we'll look back and say the story of the century was not Hitler. It was the survival of the human spirit in the face of genocide.